Hello everyone and welcome. I am Matt Suess, a fine art landscape photographer and Olympus educator up here in Bozeman, Montana. And man, I am super excited to be recording this today because I have with me something that I got a feeling a lot of people have been waiting for. Me too, as well. This is it. This is the upcoming 150 to 400 millimeter lens from Olympus. And I have obviously a hands-on review here. I've been able to be fortunate enough to have it for a few days. I'm recording this on November 15th. Tomorrow, first thing in the morning, I gotta put this in the box and ship it via FedEx to another fellow photographer and friend and Olympus educator so he can get his hands on it to do his own review. There's only a few of these out and in the wild right now. I'm so lucky to have my hands on this. This lens is amazing. And I got all the details on this. So stick with me. What we're gonna do is I'll go through some of the specs that Olympus gave me, let you know all the nitty gritty about it. I'll give you my opinion on what I've been doing with it, what I feel about the lens, and you know how it's been performing for me over the last couple days. And then we'll take a look at a couple photos that I've taken with this lens. So let's go through some of the specs here in particular. Now this has probably one of the longest names of a lens I've ever heard. This is the Olympus. It's the M.Zuiko Digital ED 150 to 400 millimeter f4.5 TC1.25x IS Pro lens. Wow. And it is also obviously one of Olympus's largest lenses. Actually not one of, it is the largest lens that they have in the Micro Four Thirds format. And I'll talk a little bit about that in a little bit here. Let's get through some more of the specs on this. Now, 150 to 400 millimeters, what that means in the 35 millimeter full frame equivalent world, that means that this is a 300 to 800 millimeter focal length equivalent lens in 35 millimeter world. Now, whenever I say the equivalent of 35 millimeter, I'm going to be talking specifically just about the focal length. Now, this has a built-in teleconverter, a 1.25 teleconverter. I don't know how they did this, but this is awesome to have a built-in teleconverter. And in the when you're using the 1.25 teleconverter, it ends up being a 187.5 millimeter to 500 millimeter lens. Now in the 35 millimeter world, that's a 35 millimeter to a 1000 millimeter lens. Your maximum aperture decreases. Instead of 4.5, it drops down to 5.6. On a 1.4x, this will use the MC14 teleconverter. Using that with the built-in 1.25 teleconverter, we're now looking at 262.5 millimeters to 700 millimeters. And in the 35 millimeter world, that's a 525 millimeter to 1400 millimeter lens at f7.9 is the maximum aperture. You can also use this with the MC20, the 2X teleconverter. And when you're doing that, your numbers are crazy. It's a 375 millimeter to 1000 millimeter lens now. And the equivalent of that in 35 millimeter world is a 750 to 2000 millimeter F11 lens. Unbelievable, 2000 millimeters. And I've taken some photos with the 2X. Actually, I shot the sun today, photographed the sun with the 2X on it. I have a solar filter that from back when we had the eclipse a few years ago. This filter size here is a 95 millimeter. Back then I was shooting with a 150 to 600 millimeter Sigma or Tamron lens for my full frame, back in my full frame days. And it has the same filter millimeter. So my solar filter fit right on top of this. I was able to photograph the sun and basically almost get the sun full frame. I was a little bummed I didn't see any sunspots on the sun today, but man, unbelievable. We have no moon right now, so I wish I could take a photo of the moon just to see the reach on that. But you know, this lens is gonna be perfect for wildlife photographers, sports photographers. I mean, those are the two main ones right there. In addition to that, it's also really good for landscapes. And I'm going to show you some landscape photos that I photographed yesterday when I was in Yellowstone. And it is also fabulous for macro photography. Let me give you some specs on macro photography. All right, first I'm going to talk about the 35 millimeter equivalent maximum image magnification. And when you're at the widest at 150 millimeters, that's 0.25x. When you're at the telephoto at 400 millimeters, that ends up being a 0.57x magnification. Now, when you use the built-in teleconverter, that increases to a 0.31x all the way up to a 0.71x magnification. And again, super, super sharp. Speaking about the built-in teleconverter, this thing is fabulous. I have not noticed any loss of sharpness using that at all. Same thing when I put on the MC14, hardly any loss of sharpness. I mean, I'm actually seeing maybe a little bit more sharpness than when I'm using my 300 millimeter F4 Olympus lens and the MC14. Now, with the MC20, I did have a little bit of problems. I was able to photograph the sun perfectly. Out in the field, though, I did have a couple problems with that. It might just be user error. You know, when you're photographing with this strong magnification, any little thing that you do can affect the sharpness of it. Also, the heat rays coming up from the earth, that can affect it too. So I might've gotten some distortion on that. This is also, again, this is a, there's only a couple of these out in the wild right now. My teleconverters haven't been updated with any firmware for this lens. My camera hasn't been updated for any firmware for this lens. So I'm expecting to see some really fabulous results once everything's up and shipping with the MC20. So again, I just did very limited testing on it. I had a couple soft photos, but it could have been just from the heat rays, could have been from, you know, the camera just not having all the firmware. So we'll withhold any opinions on that for a while, but I'll tell you what, with the MC14, unbelievable sharpness on that. Let's go ahead and geek out on a couple more stats right away here. The lens construction, it has 28 elements in 18 groups. The built-in teleconverter, has 7 elements in 4 groups. There's 1 EDA lens, 4 super ED lenses, 2 ED lenses, 2 HR lenses, and 1 HD lens. This is also, let's talk about the splash proofness of this. This has the IEC standard publication 60529 IPX1 rating, and that applies when the lens is used with the Olympus splash-proof body and dust-proof construction. So any of your pro lens or pro bodies, this is what that entails. And so it's splash-proof, it's dust-proof, really rugged. I've heard some stories from a couple other Olympus photographers that have used this lens out in the rain. I was using it out in the snow, no issues at all. I would not be worried at all using this lens in inclement weather, like any of your other pro gear from Olympus. Your angle of view, ranging from 150 millimeters to 400 millimeters, 8.2 degrees down to 3.1 degrees. And with the built-in teleconverter, your angle of view goes from 6.6 degrees down to 2.5 degrees. And let me tell you something, when you're out there photographing, when you're at this high magnification, this lens, it's gonna take some practice getting used to it. When you're out there photographing and you got this at 400 and you got the 1.25 teleconverter enabled, trying to be able to look through and spot, like for instance, a songbird on a branch, that is really tough because, and, you know, again, you have a angle of view of only 2.5 degrees. So even I was having a little bit of trouble trying to find my subject. I'd see the bird up there trying to find my subject through the lens. It's going to take some practice. One thing I recommend is zooming out down to 150, looking for your subject, and then going ahead and zooming in to get that close shot that you want. Another thing about this is that the zoom is super smooth, really, really responsive. And you know, notice nothing is moving outside on this lens. The lens doesn't get larger or smaller when you're using the zoom. And same thing with the focus. This is the focusing ring right out here. With the focusing ring, this is the manual focusing ring. I have large hands, so I did find it pretty easy for me to grip. It's a little bit further away than this bottom plate that I'm used to, so it did take a little bit of muscle memory time to really get used to the feel for this, but now I really like how this is. Got some really nice balance with this grip. My fingers can zoom in right here, and even at the same time, I can be adjusting both the zoom ring and the focusing, the manual focusing ring, should I need to do any manual focusing. Let's go back to some more stats on this. So the minimum aperture on this lens is f22, and with the built-in teleconverter, it is f29. As far as image stabilization performance, it has a 5-axis sync image stabilization, giving you up to 8 stops of image stabilization. And when you're photographing with such high millimeters, you need that image stabilization, and it works very, very well on this camera. The weight of the lens by itself is 1,875 grams, about 4.13 pounds, and that is without the lens hood on it. And in terms of its overall size, we're seeing it right here compared side by side to the 300mm f4 lens. Obviously, it's a lot bigger lens, but it will still fit in a carry-on bag. And let me show you this here. I got my Think Tank Photo travel bag. This is a backpack that I use whenever I'm flying. Fits perfectly in the overhead compartments. And look at this. This is going to fit perfectly inside your camera bag, your travel bag. And you'll have room for extra batteries, a couple extra lenses. This is going to be perfect for those going on safari, those going on vacation, anyone that needs to travel. It's just unbelievable to have a lens in this millimeter range to be able to take on a carry-on that, one, is going to be very light, and two, is going to be small enough that you can put it in the overhead compartment. And talking about light, I've been photographing with this for a little while here. And I mean, I was photographing birds for a couple hours in my backyard. I was out in Yellowstone all day, hand holding this all day. This is not a heavy setup. Now, I know everyone, or most everyone, has come to Micro Four Thirds for the smaller camera bodies, the smaller lenses, and the lighter weight. And that's one of the reasons why I did too. Obviously, again, this is a lot bigger than the 300 F4. Some people complain that the M1X camera, this is right here, is too big of a camera. This camera is perfectly balanced on this lens. And with this millimeter that you have here, it is going to be bigger than what you're probably used to with some of the smaller lenses and smaller cameras. But man, compare this to anything compared to 35mm full frame. This right here is unbelievable. Again, I can hand hold this all day and not be tired at all. Some other items about the overall construction. This right here, the front here is rubberized to help protect the front of the lens. You got rubber grips here for your manual focus and for your zoom. Right here, this knob right here will release your tripod collar and allow you to rotate it. It actually clicks into place at 90 degree spots. So that's perfect when you want to switch into the vertical. Just click it, tighten it right down. There is also a rubber grip right down, right above here to help with holding the lens. There is a spot over here to attach a strap to it. There's also a opening over here to allow a lock to, if you needed to lock this up to anything, you can put a specific custom lock inside there. Over here on the side is the built-in teleconverter. So that's at 1x and that is at 1.25x. There is a set button right up on top here. And this is really cool because what you do is, let's say you're photographing, I'll give you two scenarios. You're photographing birds in the backyard and you got this tree branch that they always land on that same specific spot, but then they're also, going to the feeder, they're going here and there, but that branch, that's what you really want to focus on. You want to get that shot there. So, or another scenario is, you're shooting sports, baseball game, and there's always a great play at second base. There's usually a great play at second base, makes for a great photo. So a lot of photographers will pre-focus on second base, and you can do this with this lens. You hit that set button, and when you focus on that, hit that set button, that commits that specific focusing in memory, in the lens's memory, so that then you can go ahead and focus on other objects. And then if you want to get back to that specific focusing point that you set, just click on any one of these black buttons that go all the way around the lens, and that will instantly bring your focus back to that preset focus point. That is super cool, super handy, and it's neat that they have these all over the place. There's, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4 of them. So no matter if you're holding this vertically, if you're holding it horizontally, you always have access to that button and get that camera right in that preset focusing point. On the side here, we also have a couple other settings here. We got a focus limiter, so we can set it from 1.3 to 6 meters. So that's going to be the focus range when you're doing the autofocus. If you're photographing macro, you're not going to want this all of a sudden missing focus and going out to infinity to then wait for it to come back into focus. There's the middle range, which is 1.3 meters to infinity. Or if you're not photographing anything close and you want to have the fastest autofocus in terms of having, if the focus slips, you'd go to 6 meters to infinity. You got a button for turning the autofocus off and just going on to manual focus, and the image stabilization on and off. This here, this button, the L.FN or the preset, if you wanted to do the focus, the saving the preset focus that I was just talking about a minute earlier, have that on preset. If you want to specify a certain lens function in camera, you'd switch that to the LFN button. That's similar on a lot of Olympus Pro lenses. And then we have a little beep icon on and off. If you leave that on, when you set your focus, the lens is going to beep really quiet. You can barely even hear it, just to give you a little bit of confirmation that you set your pre-focusing. And speaking about macro photography, one thing I did want to point out is that eventually we'll get some new updated firmware in the cameras, and you'll be able to do in-camera focus stacking with this lens. So that is really cool. So I mean, you know, as big of a lens this is going to make a really nice macro lens. This is a magnesium alloy body. The lens hood itself is a fiber hood, and it gives a really good weight balance. They decided to do that for the weight balance with the when you have the hood on the lens. There is also a fluorine coating on the lens to make wiping water off very easy. The water just ends up bubbling and you can wipe it off really easy instead of smearing that water all over. Some lenses are just a pain if you get any water drops on the front element to wipe clean. Let's talk about this white coating for a moment here. This is, right now, Olympus's only lens that has white on it. People are like, oh, well, Canon has white. Is this why Olympus is doing that? And no, Olympus actually had lenses that were white back in the 60s and the 70s. And they went white with this lens because it is so big to reduce heat. With a black lens, the sun baking on that with a lens this big, it's just going to get way too hot. So they went with a white coating on that to reduce heat. And in terms of the heat suppression, they have a base suppression level, then a heat shield layer, and then the overcoat layer that you have of this white. There is also a Z coating nano to significantly reduce ghosts and flares for sharp, clear image quality. All right, now let's talk about the important stuff here. When is this lens going to be available? Well, I am recording this 2 days on November 15th. I'm recording it 2 days before the public announcement. You'll see this video the day of the public announcement on November 17th, 2020. And that's when the lens gets announced. The price in the United States is $7,499.99. And in Canada, that is $9,999.99. I believe the pre-orders are going to start right when the lens is announced. Don't quote me on that, but I'm pretty sure they will. Availability, we're looking at most likely the end of January. And from what I've been told, there is going to be very limited supply, especially in the beginning. This lens is going to be extremely popular. And I don't, you know, anyone that shoots Olympus, that shoots wildlife and sports, and even landscape and macro, I mean, they're going to want this lens. So demand is going to be extremely high for this. You know, they may even get some more people coming from other systems to Olympus to get this lens. So if this is in your budget and on your radar, go ahead and place your orders as soon as you can. Olympus is also offering a protection filter for the front element that will go onto the front. That protection filter is going to be US$324.99, so $324.99 in the USA and $429.99 in Canada. So what are my thoughts about this lens? I have been looking forward to this lens ever since I heard the rumors that they were making it, ever since Olympus said that they were confirmed that they were going to be making this lens. I have been so excited about this lens, and being able to photograph this for the last couple days, honestly, it is one of my favorite lenses. I have a lot of Olympus gear, a lot of lenses. I have a lot of favorite lenses. This thing right here is just unbelievable. It's at the top of any Olympus lens I've ever shot with. The range is amazing. You know, a 300 millimeter equivalent at the base all the way up to 800 millimeters at the base without using the built-in teleconverter. I was shooting a lot of really cool landscape photos in Yellowstone that I just never would have been able to photograph before because I never had the reach in millimeters. You know, just vistas just from way off in the distance, trees and whatnot. And of course, obviously with animals, I mean, man, this is the perfect wildlife lens to have for your camera. The having that zoom range to be able to zoom in and out on the wildlife, you know, so you can really frame the perfect shot, and having this far reach is just fabulous. And you know, I have no problem with Olympus going up to it, even at least 3200 ISO. So even when I'm using the MC14 or even the MC20, when I'm losing light because of the maximum f-stop increases, you know, forcing you to use a higher ISO to keep your shutter speed up, I'm not having any issues at all. So I am just in love with this lens. I really don't want to send it back tomorrow, but I'm gonna have to and get myself on the wait list to get my own copy of this lens. Again, the weight is perfectly balanced. It's not too heavy for me at all. Another option I didn't tell you about, they have this on the 300 as well. This is an L bracket, Arca Suess compatible, so it'll fit on, if you have L brackets to your cameras, this will just, you don't need to put an L bracket base plate on the bottom here, just put that right into your tripod head. So now we're gonna go ahead and take a look at a couple photos. I'm gonna switch over to my computer over here on the side, and we'll go through, I'll go through a couple photos, give you the settings and everything that I did when photographing, and give you a couple tips on how I got that image. I also even did shoot a little bit of video too with this, both handheld and also on a tripod, and we'll roll a couple of those videos as well. So stick around, don't go anywhere. This video is gonna continue, and all I'm gonna do is move over to the screen over here. So right now we are still in Yellowstone National Park and found a small little herd of elk, and I'm videotaping them in 4K with the new 150 to 400 millimeter Olympus lens. This lens is fabulous for close-up photos of wildlife and video as well. Man, weren't those videos awesome? So the video with the elk, that was shot with a tripod, and the other two videos, the one with the bighorn sheep, those two videos, those were shot handheld. Let's go ahead and take a quick look at some photos here that I've worked on from this lens, and let's go ahead and take a look at this one here. I wanted to show you this one because this shows you the field of view at 150 millimeters. So let's compare that with one at 500 millimeters. So this would be using it at 400, but then with the 1.25 teleconverter, built-in teleconverter, look at the difference that you get here. So this is the entire zoom range. This is at 150 with no teleconverter, and this is at 500 with the teleconverter with the 2X, or I'm sorry, the 1.25X. So really big range, it gives you a lot of versatility when shooting. Let's go ahead and take a look at one that I finished here. And so this was shot at 329 millimeters. So I was using the 1.2X teleconverter, I believe, on the shot, 1/16 of a second, f7.1 at ISO 500. Let's go back and take a look. I want to show you a photo. This is like one of the very first photos that I photographed with this setup here. And this was in my backyard. And this is of a chickadee. And this, I had the MC14 teleconverter on this. So I'm shooting at a focal length of 613 millimeters. 1/250th of a second, f7.9. This would be wide open when you're shooting with that teleconverter at ISO 2500. And this is full frame outside of me cropping it into a square. And let's go at 100% here. And I mean, look at the detail here. Unbelievable. So remember, I told you that this lens is really sharp with that teleconverter, especially the 1.4 teleconverter. That is the proof right there. And let's take a look at this white-tailed deer here. This here, let's zoom in on this guy again. I mean, look at the detail in here. Just unbelievable. Focused right on the eye. Let's take a look at my settings. This is 500 millimeters, so this would have been with a 1.25 teleconverter. 1/640th of a second, f6.3, ISO 2500. Remember, I was telling you, I have no problem with noise in here. You know, ISO 2500, look at that. That looks really nice. And as a matter of fact, all of these images that you're seeing here, these were processed with DxO PhotoLab 4. And they have it's a really fabulous program for processing raw files. Great noise reduction in it as well. I am an affiliate to them, so if you want to purchase, take a look at the links down in the caption here. If you do purchase through my affiliate link, I get a small percentage of the sale. It doesn't affect you at all, but it does help support this channel. And I do have some other links down below as well. And as I'm speaking about links, don't forget to subscribe to this YouTube channel if you like it. Let's go back to the photos and take a look at some more. I told you that this lens can work really well as a macro. Let's go into 100% on this right here. And this is a dried sunflower from our backyard garden. Look at the detail throughout here. It's just unbelievable. Let me scroll up to the top and we'll get another look up here. Again, looking at this at 100%. And you can see you don't have a whole lot of depth of field. So there's parts obviously that are out of focus, but man, those parts that are in focus, so much detail. And let's take a look at the settings on that. That was at a focal length of 419. So I was using the 1.25 built-in teleconverter, 1/600th of a second, F8 ISO 400. And going back to Yellowstone where I was there yesterday, take a look at this bison at 100%. Look at the detail. Look at the sharpness. I keep on repeating myself, but this lens is just fabulous in what it can do. And this is a full frame shot, no cropping at all. Take a look at the settings on that. 500 millimeters. This is with the 1.25 built-in teleconverter. 1/1000th of a second, f7.1 at 1250 ISO. This bighorn sheep, I mean, man. Let's zoom in on this guy here. Again, full frame shot, didn't do any cropping at all. Let's look at the camera settings, and we have here 500 millimeters. This is with the 1.25 teleconverter. I'm extended all the way. 1/1600th of a second at f8, 2500 ISO. Again, I mean, where's the noise? There's no noise in here. This is just fabulous. Beautiful, beautiful shot. And I was talking about a little bit of a softness with the MC200. This is one example here. And let's go up. This is a full frame shot going up to 100. Now I'm photographing across the road. This coyote had to be, you know, was sitting on the side of the road. Wasn't a whole lot of traffic in the park at all. And, you know, he was really close. I didn't have a whole lot of depth of field to begin with. There are sharp elements to this. So I was manually focusing on this here. And, you know, I might have missed the focus a little bit. There might have been some heat rays coming up from the road. Again, I have to do a little bit more testing. But, I mean, you know, look at the whiskers in back here. I mean, that is razor sharp. So I have a little bit of a softness in the very front, very minor. I bet you if I were to use something like Topaz sharpener, I could probably bring out some more detail and this image would be perfect. And lastly, let's finish this off with a couple landscape images. I told you that this camera is really good for landscapes. And we take a look here, and the detail in here, just unbelievable. And I had great light the day that I was at Yellowstone, too. Let's look at the settings here. So this is at 284 millimeters, 1/3200th of a second at 7.1 at ISO 400. I didn't need to use that high of a shutter speed. I could have dropped it down to about ISO 200, but I had my camera set up mostly for wildlife. So, you know, even at 400 ISO, no big deal. We've already seen how there's not a whole lot of noise in these images. And let's take a look at one last one. This one I really like a lot. Now this one here is, let's go through the settings here. This is 150 millimeters, 1/250th of a second, F8 at ISO 320. Now notice the image size. I ended up shooting this in handheld high-res mode, and this has given me a 50 megapixel image with this new lens. And check this out. I mean, just unbelievable sharpness. Going all the way down from the foreground, all the way up. Let's scan all the way up here to our tree line. And just awesome. So that wraps up this video, hands-on look at the brand new Olympus 150 to 400 millimeter lens that is coming out in January. And I'll tell you what, I am definitely getting an order in myself. How about you? Are you guys going to be ordering this? Is this the lens that you wanted? What do you think about it? Have any questions about it? Let me know. I don't have the lens anymore. I just had to ship it off. So unfortunately I can't, pick it up and answer questions, but I'm pretty familiar with it now after spending a couple days with it. So if you do have any questions, feel free to pop them in the comments down below. Don't forget to subscribe to my YouTube channel. And that is all for now. I'll talk to you later. Bye.